Simon & Schuster Audio presents Edge by Jeffery Deaver. Read by Skipp, Sudduth.
June 2004. The Rules of Play. The man who wanted to kill the young woman sitting beside me was three-quarters of a mile behind us as we drove through a pastoral setting of tobacco and cotton fields this humid morning. A glance in the rearview mirror revealed a sliver of car moving at a comfortable pace with the traffic, piloted by a man who, by all appearances, seemed hardly different from any one of 100 drivers on this recently resurfaced divided highway. "Officer Fallow," Alyssa began. Then, as I'd been urging her for the past week, "Abe?" "Yes." "Is he still there?" She'd seen my gaze. "Yes, and so's our tail," I added for reassurance. My protege was behind the killer, 2 or 3 car lengths. He was not the only person from our organization on the job.
"Okay," Alyssa whispered.
The woman, in her mid-30s, was a whistleblower against a government contractor that did a lot of work for the Army. The company was adamant that it had done nothing wrong and claimed it welcomed an investigation. But there'd been an attempt on Alyssa's life a week ago, and since I'd been in the Army with one of the senior commanders at Bragg, defense had called me in to guard her. As head of the organization, I don't do much field work any longer, but I was glad to get out, to tell the truth. My typical day was 10 hours at my desk in our Alexandria office, and in the past month it had been closer to 12 or 14 as we coordinated the protection of 5 high-level organized crime informants before handing them over to witness protection for their facelifts. It was good to be back in the saddle, if only for a week or so. I hit a speed dial button, calling my protege. "It's Abe," I said into my hands free. "Where is he now?" "Make it a half mile, moving up slowly." The hitter, whose identity we didn't know, was in a nondescript Hyundai sedan, gray. I was behind an 18-foot truck, Carolina Poultry Processing Company painted on the side. It was empty and being driven by one of our transport people. In front of that was a car identical to the one I was driving. "We've got 2 miles to the swap," I said. 4 voices acknowledged this over 4 very encrypted comm devices. I disconnected. Without looking at her, I said to Alyssa, "It's going to be fine." She said in a whisper, "I don't know." She fell silent and stared into the side-view mirror as if the man who wanted to kill her were right behind us. "It's all going just like we planned." When innocent people find themselves in situations that require the presence and protection of people like me, their reaction, more often than not, is as much bewilderment as fear. Mortality is tough to process. But keeping people safe, keeping people alive, is a business like any other. I frequently told this to my protege and the others in the office, probably irritating them to no end with both the repetition and the stodgy tone. But I kept on saying it because you can't forget, ever. It's a business, with rigid procedures that we study the way surgeons learn to slice flesh precisely, and pilots learn to keep tons of metal safely aloft. These techniques have been honed over the years, and they worked. Business. Of course, it was also true that the hitter, who was behind us at the moment, intent on killing the woman next to me, treated his job as a business too. I knew this sure as steel. He was just as serious as I was, had studied procedures as diligently as I had, was smart, IQ-wise and streetwise, and he had advantages over me. His rules were unencumbered by my constraints, the Constitution and the laws promulgated thereunder. Still, I believe there is an advantage in being in the right. In all my years of doing this work, I'd never lost a principal, and I wasn't going to lose Alyssa. A business, which meant remaining calm as a surgeon, calm as a pilot. Alyssa was not calm, of course. She was breathing hard, worrying her cuff as she stared at a sprawling magnolia tree we were passing, an outrider of a chestnut forest bordering a huge cotton field, the tufts bursting. She was uneasily spinning a thin diamond bracelet, a treat to herself on a recent birthday. She now glanced at the jewelry and then her palms, which were sweating, and placed her hands on her navy blue skirt. Under my care, Alyssa had worn dark clothing exclusively. It was camouflage, but not because she was the target of a professional killer. It was about her weight, which she'd wrestled with since adolescence. I knew this because we shared meals, and I'd seen the battle up close. She'd also talked quite a bit about her struggle with weight. Some principals don't need or want camaraderie. Others, like Alyssa, need us to be friends. I don't do well in that role, but I try and can generally pull it off. We passed a sign. The exit was a mile and a half away. A business requires simple, smart planning. You can't be reactive in this line of work, and though I hate the word proactive, as opposed to what, anti-active, the concept is vital to what we do. In this instance, to deliver Alyssa safe and sound to the prosecutor for her depositions, I needed to keep the hitter in play. Since my protege had been following him for hours, we knew where he was and could have taken him at any moment. But if we'd done that, whoever had hired him would simply call somebody else to finish the job. I wanted to keep him on the road for the better part of the day, long enough for Alyssa to get into the U.S. Attorney's office and give him sufficient information via deposition so that she would no longer be at risk. Once the testimony's down, the hitter has no incentive to eliminate a witness. The plan I'd devised, with my protege's help, was for me to pass the Carolina poultry truck and pull in front of it. The hitter would speed up to keep us in sight, but before he got close, the truck and I would exit simultaneously. Because of the curve in the road and the ramp I'd picked, the hitter wouldn't be able to see my car, but would spot the decoy. Alyssa and I would then take a complicated route to a hotel in Raleigh, where the prosecutor awaited, while the decoy would eventually end up at the courthouse in Charlotte, 3 hours away. By the time the hitter realized that he'd been following a bogus target, it would be too late. He'd call his primary, his employer, and most likely the hit would be called off. We'd move in, arrest the hitter, and try to trace him back to the primary. About a mile ahead was the turnoff. A glance in the rearview mirror, the chicken truck was about 30 feet ahead. I regarded Alyssa, now playing with a gold and amethyst necklace. Her mother had given it to her on her 17th birthday, more expensive than the family could afford, but an unspoken consolation prize for the absence of an invitation to the prom. People tend to share quite a lot with those who are saving their lives. My phone buzzed. "Yes," I asked my protege. "The subject has moved up a bit, about 200 yards behind the truck." "We're almost there," I said. "Let's go." I passed the poultry truck quickly and pulled in behind the decoy, a tight fit. It was driven by a man from our organization. The passenger was an FBI agent who resembled Alyssa. There'd been some fun in the office when we picked somebody to play the role of me. I have a round head and ears that protrude a fraction of an inch more than I would like. I've got wiry red hair, and I'm not tall. So in the office, they apparently spent an hour or two in an impromptu contest to find the most elf-like officer.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.